Hey guys, so I've been playing around with the Logic environment today. Not the easiest thing to get to grips with. Don't know if you've looked at the manual, but it's almost impossible to understand. Anyway, I found a little other tutorial on the web, so I tried to turn it into a video. I'm trying to anyway. So please forgive me if it's not as clear as it could be. I'm just getting to grips with it. So what we've got here is effectively a called chaos pad. In Logic, or in fact four chaos pads, so you've got these four vectors controlling different dimensions of effects. So this one up on the right is controlling an auto filter, this one down at the bottom is controlling a bit crusher, this one on the left bottom is controlling a tape delay, so you could hear it kind of was increasing the feedback rate, and this one on the top left is controlling the EQ. So you can do it with whatever set of effects you've got. So what you'd do is you'd start off in your arrange window. You'd have a track which you'd wanted to basically do some of this controlling on. And I've just got an EXS24 inserted with some sounds. Then you would go to window environment. And the first time you went in, you probably wouldn't have to resize it, but if you did, just resize it. And the first time you opened it, what you'd get is most likely the mixer. And what I've done in the mixer page is I've gone up and I've created a monitor. What this monitor does, let's just get rid of the existing one. So what the monitor does is it tells me some control data or some information about the different controls that are going on. So if I if I link it into the monitor, open up an auto filter and then play around with, say, the cutoff, I can see that it's saying fader 4 number 2. So what a fader 4 is referring to this auto filter. The cutoff is number 2, resonance is number 3, distortion input is number 0, and on and on and on. I've already got all those things controlled. Don't know why I just got rid of my monitor. I don't want to do that. There we go. But let's see, so let's change this platinum verb. So Let's change the wetness of the signal, which is fader 7, number 19, and the reverb time, which is fader 7, number 8. Okay, so F7, number 8, and number 19. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy that channel strip, and when you do it, what you're going to do is you're going to go create layer. I've already got a layer created. And it is not, it's this one. And then what you'd do is you'd paste in your channel strip. Now obviously I don't need to do that because it's already there. And what I've noticed as I've added other channel strips, they start appearing in this layer as well. So they're available then to affect via these. So actually you could control multiple effects. Okay, so the next thing we're gonna do is we're going to create a new fader, and it's going to be one of these vectors. So I've got my vector, I take the output of my vector to the input of the channel that I want to affect and make sure it's selected, and these are all my controls on my fader now. So the first thing I need to do is drag and click this one, turn that into a fader, and the same with the horizontal. Let's open up the PT verb so we can see what's going on. So we said that the fader was number 7, if I remember correctly. And I need to do it on the horizontal as well. And we had 8 and 19, didn't we? So 8 and 19. So there we go. So if I now start moving my... very nice, look at that. So if you now start moving, you've got a very nice control of your platinum verb. and you can do all things like you can resize it by dragging in the corner there. You can add in some colors to make it a little bit prettier. Colors, let's make it, doesn't really matter, orange. There we go. Next thing I did was, this is a bit messy now because when I started adding the channel strips, they start getting in the way of what I'd set up. So what you can do is create a new layer just with the objects that you want to take through. So it's still going to do all the control for you, but it's going to look a lot cleaner. So if I just took that and I do a copy, and now what again, what you're going to do is you're going to go create layer, and then you're going to drop it in. I've already got another layer created. It's this one here. So with all the controls of the different units, and I can just paste this one in. So again, it's, I mean, this is a kind of a very quick and dirty tutorial. It's really quick. So you'd probably resize it and get it looking really nice. And then let me just go back and demonstrate to you. So let's open a couple of these effects. So this top right one is controlling my auto filter. You can see cutoff and resonance there. Very nice. Got the bit crusher. For some reason, so I've got it controlling resolution and downsampling. Now, most of the controls happening in down here in this quadrant on the bottom left-hand side. I'm not quite sure why that is. The others actually you can use the whole area, but you can see as soon as I go past that central middle bit, it's all kind of nothing's happening there. But if I go to the left and I go down, it's all happening in this bottom left-hand quadrant. So just bearing that in mind once you when you download the project. This one down here is controlling my tape delay. So there you go, I've got the feedback and the wet signal. One thing that I did on this is, I thought I did on this. I think I did. Sorry, didn't mean to move it, I just wanted to select it. Is, yeah, so I limited the range. If you've used the tape delay before, if you have that feedback too high, I think the cutoff is about 54%. Once it goes beyond 54%, the feedback, it just feeds back on itself and it can get quite nasty. So what I've done is I've limited the range that this can move to. So you can see even when I take it to extreme, it's stopping at 60% there and 60% there, just so it saves your ears effectively. Otherwise, you're not going to be happy if I'd not put that limit on. What else can I tell you? Okay, I got a channel EQ going on, and just controlling. There we go. Yeah, just controlling the frequency and the gain, and that's my customized chaos pad. And then we've got this new layer now, and this is my PT verb. Now I'm sure there's people out there who can do a lot more complex environments, but I think this is a mini triumph for myself. As I say, it's a fairly complex thing to get to grips with, especially if you read the manual. There's actually quite a few good tutorials out on the web if you can be bothered to spend the time. As I say, I'll download this. If you've got an iPad, then this would be really good because you could then control two of these at one go. So I don't have an iPad, like the advert says. I don't have an iPad, then I don't have an iPad. Which is really quite annoying, but there you go. So for now, even if you don't have like a touch control surface, this is going to allow you to be a lot more creative with your effects and allow you to set up kind of just like settings that you'd just never think of if you're going into the into your effects unit itself. You're controlling it two dimensions. Now, if you're just doing that with click and drag within the effects unit, you can't control two dimensions in one go, two parameters. So that's why this is nice. So that's it. Quick video on the environment. I hope that's not kind of too unclear. It's one of those things that is just not intuitive, but it's also one of the things that I kind of turn Logic into something really quite powerful, beyond like just its competitors. So hope that was useful. Give it a go. In the next few days, I'll get the template downloaded so you can at least have a go with this one, and then you can start modifying it and maybe publish some of your own that I can share around with the rest of the subscribers. So, cheers. Oh, one last thing I meant to say. It's not just meant for distorted and messed up sounds like this. You can actually just put any effects chain in that you want. It's the bit crusher that's making this sound a bit kind of distorted and nasty and gritty and grimy. But you could do this on, I guess it'd be great for things like minimal techno, where you might just want to kind of give a splash of reverb every now and again. It'd be great for other styles of music. It's not just for kind of this kind of nasty dubstepy sort of gritty grimy stuff. And that's it. Cheers.